song I grew up with goes something like this. I saw the light, I saw the light, no more in darkness, and then whatever the rest is.
No more.
Night.
Night.
Yeah, it's a great song. Mm-hmm. This is what it's based on. Saul's journey, remember, we covered it. He saw the light, bang. What I want to start off with tonight is we want to, how dramatic conversion is, not just Saul's.
Mm.
Conversion.
Yeah.
Conversion to Christ is the most dramatic change you can make. You literally are going from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. Yeah. That is what the scriptures teach us. You have now become a new creature in Jesus mm-hmm. Christ. You are a brand new creation. I'm just using a few of the scriptural references to this process. And we certainly see it with this guy.
Yeah.
And so we're still in chapter 9 and we're going to be around 19 and on with this. And he's had this dramatic conversion. Ananias is gone. He's healed of the blindness that came from the seeing the light.
Mm-hmm.
And now he is Christ. And he just rises so quickly. And I'm just going to read the first little bit, halfway through verse 19. Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. So only days, right?
Yeah.
We're not talking about weeks.
No.
He's now several days with the disciples in Damascus, the Christians, who he had come to arrest.
That's right.
And now he's going to spend several days with. And at once, he began to preach in the synagogues, the Jewish seat of power in Damascus, that Jesus is the Son of God.
So it's this exact...
Does this get more dramatic?
I know. It's the total opposite of what he actually came there to do. In his mind, and what he wholeheartedly believed was Jesus is a fraud. And this message was the exact opposite. And he's there preaching that Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Son of God. Like that is a conversion for the ages.
Both the Jewish people and the Christians, their jaws probably.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Hit the floor.
Who is this guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, because he wasn't just a proponent of the message before. He was the leader of the message that Jesus is a fraud.
Yeah.
And now he is preaching Jesus is the Son of God.
Mm-hmm.
And you see that. It says in verse 21, all those who heard him at the synagogue were astonished and asked, isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on his name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priests? So they're like going...
Yeah, they probably happened? Showed up to hear him expecting, you know, we're going to see some action. We're going to see some people arrested and dragged out of here.
Yeah,
exactly.
Their heads are just spinning.
Yeah.
And of course, this speaks to when you do have a dramatic conversion like this, people are always going to compare you to the old file they have of you, right? Yeah. That's the initial response. They're going to, oh, isn't that the guy who used to smoke dope every day and get wasted every weekend? Isn't that the girl who used to, you know, be super promiscuous and had, you know, three husbands, like, isn't that who that person is? Who do they think they are?
Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. That is where I think every conversion is dramatic.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're leaving something that was.
Yes.
Not that is. You're leaving something that was,
mm-hmm.
and now it is completely changed.
Mm-hmm.
And as a Christian, I don't know if we really understand what to be converted means, to be converted to Christ. But it is an absolute night and day change.
Yeah.
Now, of course, we all got things to work out in our life.
Yeah.
That's not the deal. Saul himself was going to spend some years in preparation for ministry.
Yeah.
But right away, the conversion shows up.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the first sign that there's a brand new file I'm living with. And I don't feel like that person.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not like that person. I'm not thinking like that person anymore.
Yeah, I appreciate what you said there about it was, the old file was. It's not something that we need to deny. It's not something that's like, oh, no, I never did that. Or, I was this, but now I got this brand new, the slate is clean. I got this brand new file, and actually... I think it's more powerful when a person does acknowledge, I was this, and now I'm this.
Yes. There's that song, Amazing Grace, and part of it is, he writes, I once was blind, but now I see.
Mm-hmm.
And again, we are referring to this particular story in Scripture.
Yeah.
But this is where this the dramatics of it, but you don't deny it.
Exactly.
Right. And that's what made a great Amazing Grace such a great hymn. Mm-hmm. It's because there's no denial. He's saying, this is what I was, mm-hmm. yeah. but this is what I am by yeah. the grace of God now.
Yeah, that's what shows the power of God's grace. As Christians, we don't need to deny that that was who we once were. But also, as Saul is evidenced here, he didn't allow that to hold him back from the powerful ministry. I think so many yes. of us use that as an excuse. Well, everybody knows me as this. How are they going to take me seriously when I tell them what's happened now? Well, that's why. That's your testimony. That's yeah. the power of your testimony is God's grace was big enough to cover that.
Yes.
I wonder how many people, because I myself can relate to this. I wonder how many people, you know, they park it at the, I was this. Mm. And then that keeps, oh yeah, I, you're right. I did all do all these things. I was this. And then it keeps them from fully embracing the, but now mm-hmm. I'm this. I'm a brand new creation.
Your question is a very good question. And the answer is really simple. One is too many. Where we yeah. allow our function in this new conversion to be hindered by our past file.
Yes.
Because Christ has set us free from all of that. Mm-hmm. Galatians 2:20 says, I have been set free.
Yeah.
I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Mm-hmm. Yet it's not I, but Christ that lives in me. More or less, there's this whole conversion experience out of which I am now belonging here. And it does concern me because I do see almost like people almost shy to function in a new ID.
Mm-hmm.
And we shouldn't be.
Mm-mm.
Because that new ID exists because of him, not
mm-hmm.
you. This new file is him.
It's yeah. him, yeah.
Not you.
Yeah. When you see someone's big weight loss, you, oh, what did you do? What did you do to lose all, you know, like it's this, what happened to create this big change? But this is even more, right? This is this evidence of a life changed and an eternity that we are assured of and that we can live like we're free if we really step into this and believe it and own it with everything.
And if you make Christ the foundation yeah. of your new idea, you'll have confidence
yes.
to function
yes.
in the new way. And it's interesting because it goes on. It says, yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus mm-hmm. is the Christ. So he didn't let his history of
yeah.
having families broken up, thrown into prison, I'm sure some killed, beaten, all of this stuff going on. He did not let that keep him from his new idea.
That's right.
ID here. He is now preaching Jesus is the Christ.
Mm-hmm.
The opposite he had preached before. And these other people, they're absolutely baffled by it.
Yeah.
People that know you and know your rep, when you become a Christian, they should be baffled
yeah.
by your new function
yeah.
that is based on a new ID. Never try to think that somehow by functioning this way with them that you can bring them to conversion. You function mm-hmm. in where Christ is making you.
Yeah, don't try to ease people into your new life. Let them be wowed by it. Let them doubt it.
Exactly.
The fruit, and over time, it will show this true conversion.
Or even angered by it.
And he does experience that, of course. But yeah, let them be wowed by it. We don't have to worry about making people comfortable with what is and should be a very uncomfortable faith.
It should be uncomfortable for them.
Mm-hmm.
If you live your faith,
yeah,
it's going to make them baffled. It's going to make them and with here's where it went with Saul. It says after many days had gone by, the Jews conspired to kill him.
Mm.
Well, okay, we got the Jesus killed Jesus all over again.
Yeah.
See, but this one thing you must understand about persecution, I think, folks, I think all of us need to understand this, is that persecution is just trying to kill Jesus all over again.
Yes.
It's Jesus that they're persecuting.
That's right.
You think it's you. It's Jesus.
Yes.
It's Jesus they're persecuting. You think the people around you that give you a little verbal hard time because of your faith or whatever are persecuting. They're not persecuting you.
No.
They're persecuting Jesus. It's always about Jesus, see?
Mm-hmm.
And so I find comfort in that.
Yeah.
But you know what? I don't even need to take this personal.
Yeah, exactly.
This is about Jesus. They don't like you, Lord.
Yeah.
They really don't like you. They don't like what you say. They don't like your truth. They don't like you calling them sinners. And they don't like you dying on a cross. And they don't even like your grace.
Yeah.
Like, it's the Jesus they don't like.
That's right.
And they want to kill Paul. And so, same deal.
Yeah.
Kill Jesus. Kill Jesus. Kill Jesus. Kill Jesus.
Stop him. Stop Jesus. Stop Jesus. You know, same stuff. Anyway, but his followers help him escape.
Yeah, they lower him in a basket through an opening in the wall. So, I mean, he's already got followers for one, right? And they're helping him make a little getaway. And then it says, when he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. And that kind of just reminds me, like, sort of in recent media of Kanye West, you know, making this declaration that he's a born-again Christian. And, you know, many believers and non-believers, of course, had their, you know, they were quite concerned about this. And, oh, if this guy is claiming to be a believer, what's that going to look like, right? He has this huge following. Will there be any fruit? Is it going to make us look like fools? You know, there's a lot of doubt there.
Yeah. It's the old file, right?
Yeah.
And how do you prove that your old file is a brand new file?
Mm-hmm.
Time.
Time, yeah.
Yeah, and what Saul did.
Yeah.
So Barnabas brings him and brought him to the apostles,
mm-hmm.
brought him to the center of Christian authority,
yeah.
and said, look, he told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him. But that's not where they stop. It didn't stop at his just experience of meeting Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Then Barnabas goes on, and that the Lord had spoken to him and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus.
That's it.
So he went right to the action. He lived the new ID, guys.
Yeah. Yep.
That's his new file.
He went and preached, not Jesus is a fraud, but Jesus is the Son of God, and turned Damascus upside down. Guys, they wanted to kill him. We had to sneak him out of there.
Yeah.
You know, he was coming in with soldiers and horses and a big entourage. He leaves in a basket over the wall.
Yeah.
And so they're going to the action to say, this guy is definitely from the new ID.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's fruit already.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a beautiful story, actually.
It is. It's very cool.
So Saul, he stays with them and he moves about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. And he talked and debated with the Grecian Jews. This would be just people of Jewish faith. They could be Greeks, but became Jews. And they came back to Jerusalem, and they're there. But they tried to kill him. So he's a very powerful debater.
Mm.
But now he's the main target.
Yeah.
And they want to take him out.
Yeah.
And they try to take him out again. When the brothers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. Interesting. Get him out of town again. That was Paul's ministry, by the way.
Hmm.
In town, then get him out of town.
Out with a flash.
In town, get him out of town.
Yeah.
In town, get him out of town.
Wow.
And that's how this guy's ministry unfolded. Just because, again, of Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah. The message was so dangerous, and he was being used so powerfully to spread this message that it had to be a dine and dash, right? It had to be a spread the word of God and get moving.
And we were talking earlier about the beauty of this whole situation, that Saul was the biggest enemy of the Christian faith, the biggest enemy by far at that time. And not only did God extinguish the enemy in that sense, but as you put it, he took out a Saul and he added a Paul.
Right. Took out the biggest enemy and brought in the biggest contributor, right?
Like, it's amazing.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. And we find that for a time right after that, the church experienced some peace and probably, I would think, exponential growth because Paul was added to them.
Exactly. Stronger than ever.
Yeah.
And I would just close off our segment with that thought for you, is that, you know, God is always about his work and he's changing you too. But that conversion experience that you've had, please understand the power of it. God has already translated you from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. God has already turned you into a new creature and a new creation. God has already done all of his work. Now he's going to be working it out through you. And you have to, yes, be a disciple and learn and grow. But that conversion experience is your new ID. Celebrate it, grab it, function in it. Don't apologize for it. And if it gets you in trouble, it's actually Jesus getting you in trouble. And if Jesus gets me in trouble, that's okay with me. Lord bless you. Enjoy the rest of your night.
Talk to you about prayer having to do with your new ID that we talked about. When you're converted to Christ, something incredible happens. You have been moved into God's kingdom. You've left the kingdom of darkness. You are a brand new creature. You are in God's family. You are part of His eternal family. You're not just born in His creation. You have now become His eternal creation. That gives you an amazing position to pray from. You are in the house. You're in the dining room. You are with Him in the most intimate places. He has welcomed you into His home, into His throne room. This is what He has opened up to you. So you can sit down as His child and you can bring to Him your needs and your concerns and all the different things he may even burden you with or use you for to pray for in this world. There's a great scripture in Galatians in 2:20 that says, I have been crucified with Christ. That means there's a death process in conversion. I have been crucified. The life where I just live for me is gone. My old ID disappeared. And I no longer live. That ID is dead and gone. But Christ lives in me. There's my new ID. It's based on his life in me. The life I now live in the body, how I'm living it out now in my daily life, I live by faith in the Son of God, Jesus, who loved me and gave himself for me. This is telling us his devotion to you, how he loves you. And you just live in the faith of his goodness towards you, the new ID of him in you. And now when you pray, you're sitting down with Jesus, who gave his very life for you. How much more does he not want to hear from you, the prayers from your heart, as he puts burdens upon you, puts you into lives of others, or leads you through the valleys of your own? Don't you think he's intimately caring and open and want to hear? He's given everything he's got for you. Your prayer back to him is an expression of a new ID. And you can sit down and you can just say, Jesus, I'm so grateful for what you have made me. I was in darkness. I'm now in light. And Lord, I want to talk to you about some things that need to continue to change. Maybe in me, maybe in my circumstances. Here's some needs. Lord's Prayer, our Father, then thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, right? And then it goes into give us this day our daily bread. Lord, we want to forgive those that have hurt us. He goes to all these different references of prayer, but it's always on that, our Father. He's given you his very best. Sit down. Just talk to him about these things. You have an ID in him. You belong in that living room talking to him. Talk. Bring him the needs. Know what conversion to Christ has done for you. You know, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you need to be converted to Christ. You need to accept Christ. He's got a brand new ID for you. You do that through faith. You do that through Jesus. I want you to forgive me for my sins. I want you to come into my life. I want you to turn me into a follower of yours. I want my new ID, you in me, me alive in this world. Enjoy the rest of your night.